Men are fantastic. They make great stuff, like the Mona Lisa and Star Wars. And they build the Eiffel Tower, and they make wheelies on their bikes, and they build huge sandcastles. And men are very wise, like Socrates, like Shakespeare, like Bob Dylan, like Louis van Gaal. And men can be very brave, and they liberate us, like Multatuli, like Gandhi, like Martin Luther King, like Churchill. And men can be so funny, like the football fans from Ireland who sing to the Swedish football fans, "Go home to your sexy wives, go home." And men can be gentle and caring and kind, like young fathers, like Clemens, like Arthur, and like David. I want to tell you about Clemens and Annika. They got together when she was 19 and he was 25. And Clemens, he wasn't much of a talker. And whenever she would ask what was going on, he would run out the door, drive off, and she would be happy if he came back at all. So she wouldn't ask again. But the love was there, she told me, and so were the children. And consider Arthur and Carla. Arthur was a proud and ambitious man, always knowing which way to go, and Carla, she was happily following. His only hiccup, maybe, was that he was too strong, never allowing himself to hesitate. And then he lost his job and much of his self-respect, and he had to show his vulnerable side to Carla. And the moment he confessed to her that he needed her, she told me, is one of her most precious memories of their relationship. And David was a happy, proud father of three, and a proud husband, and a loyal employee, and a favorite neighbor in a cheerful neighborhood, always eager to be trustworthy and righteous, so he worked his ass off to make everybody happy, and never complaining, and always saying he was all right. Annika and Clemens are having dinner. The children are out, and they are arguing again. Annika says she wants to sleep in the attic room, alone. Clemens gets angry and runs up the stairs. And a few seconds later, she hears a bump. And Annika thinks he has expanded the sofa bed for her. But Clemens doesn't come down. So after about 10 minutes, Annika goes up, and there she finds Clemens. The chair, the bump, was the chair under his feet. Carla is at work, and Arthur is at home. He's been there for a few months now. He calls her emotionally. She has to come home right away. And when she gets there, the house is empty, but she finds a note on the table. It's a suicide note. Carla runs up the stairs, and there is Arthur, sitting, crying. He confesses he spent all their money on online poker, and just this morning, he found out all their accounts are empty. Carla gets angry at first, but then starts comforting him and insists they will fix this together. She goes out to get the children, but when she comes home, there's a new note, and it says, "I'm sorry." And Carla runs up the stairs again, but this time she's too late. It is March 2015 when David calls in sick. His new job is not working out for him at all and makes him question all his abilities and everything connected with it. The psychologist he consults is worried. David shows signs of severe depression and should get proper treatment. But somehow, this doesn't happen. And on May 20th, his wife is out for about an hour. And when she comes home, David has taken his life. It's my brother. Can you imagine being at the office, picking up the phone, And it's your mother howling, calling your brother, he's not answering, calling his wife. She's telling you he died, calling your sister, your brothers, your wife. And I'm cycling home on a beautiful sunny day in Amsterdam with cheerful people on the terraces. Coming home, holding your wife, telling your children, packing your stuff because you don't know how this day is going to end. And then driving all the way from west to east and hoping you don't see the ambulance in front of his door, because that is true. And seeing the police car in front of his door, so it is true. And you enter the house, and the police officer says, it's not a felony. You're therefore allowed to go up to his room. And there you go, because you were always a head first guy, and you don't want your mother to go first. And then you enter the room, and your knees buckle. I wrote this all down the same night on May 20th, 2015, and those words would literally become the first sentences of a goal in my life. And why, after the shock and the mourning and the grieving and the arranging, I started wondering how this could have happened to my happy and steady brother. Because I saw scores of Davids, of men, who I knew they were saying they were all right, but from I knew for sure they were not all right. A few friends divorcing against their will, some relatives and other pals battling depression, a friend marking his 25-year drug addiction. And of course, these men were always there, but I never saw a common ground they stood on. So after that, I started looking to the numbers. And the first number I stumbled on were the suicide numbers. In 2017, in the Netherlands, 1,304 men against 613 women. And the ratio has been 2-1 for 20 years now. The ratio in Belgium and the UK is 3-1. In the US, it's 3.5-1. In Poland, the ratio, the suicide ratio, is 10 men against one woman. So, after what happened to my brother, and the awareness of my friends and these numbers, I started wondering what could be wrong, because the other numbers told me that men between 40 and 60 are a risk group for suicide. Men like me, and not alcoholics, not addicts, not divorced men, no, just men my age. And completely other statistics show that women in the Netherlands are depressed more than twice as men. So something's not adding up there. So I put all this together, and a terrible question dawned upon me. Can men handle their primal emotions, like fear, like anger, like sadness, like even happiness? And right after that, I wondered, do we even care about that? I still don't know much. There's no big life-saving idea. I just want to start a conversation about what it means to be a man in this day and age. And for this, I interviewed 11 widows of men, normal fathers, whose lives took a troubling turn, Annika and Carla among those widows. And those turned out to be 11 troubling stories of men losing their grip on life and not being able to share this, and then doing what nobody expected. And those stories had a few common factors I'd like to share. The first one is those men didn't think they were good enough. And the second, they had a hard time dealing with their emotions. And the third, almost all of them did not have a good relationship with their father. And the fourth, they must have been so lonely. And those were 11 telling, beautiful conversations between equals, not between an interviewer and a subject, tears and silences on both sides. After these talks, I dug a little deeper into the science of suicide and men. and I want to present some facts. The first one, most suicide survivors, researchers found out, are socially prescribed perfectionists, meaning your self-image is based on what you think other people think of you. And you cannot know that. So you're never good enough. You're always failing. And men keep those feelings tucked inside, among other feelings. And inside they can grow unchecked, they can multiply. Rather die, to overstate it, than ask for help. And two, a lot of men did not have the benefit of a role model, somebody who told them how to deal with power or responsibility, how to grow up. This role model should, of course, have been the father, but he disappeared from the home long ago. And three, to make it a little worse, boys do not have biological markers that turn them into men. Girls do, that turn them into women. We don't have breasts and the other gender looking at them. We don't give birth, we don't have periods. Actually, boys have to see to the transition themselves, and you can only hope it happens in a healthy way. And four, the big picture, society these days is not about surviving anymore. It's about how we relate to things. But we still teach boys to be a warrior, and we still expect them not to cry like a girl. Actually, we understand angry men, but we difficulty understand sad and frightened men. Don't get me wrong, millions of men are doing great, fantastic, but do not only look at the suicide numbers. Who are the car crashers? Who are inside jails? Who are the alcoholics? Who are the drug addicts? Who are the killers and the ones being killed? And look at the preventable diseases. Men die worldwide 7 years earlier than women. It's a fact of life. But should it be a fact of life? Before coming to some sort of an answer, which is actually the opposite of an answer, I'd like to share a personal story. David and my father, they differed a lot, but they had one thing in common. Whenever I would ask them how they were doing, they would answer, goed, 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 goed. Meaning, fine, fine. Meaning, don't worry about me. It's not important how I am doing. And I realized this only after they both had deceased. This little anecdote is in my book, Man on Man, in which I argue for a lot of big questions, like, are you sure your father loves you? But now I think that's too big a question. I don't want to provoke men, I want to side with them. So I decided to tune down those questions, make them pure, pristine, simple. And I shall tell you why. I think the question is in the answer, and the answer is in the question. Because, as you all know, women these past 100 years have been fighting for freedom. And women are already connected. That makes it a great fight. And men have been struggling for freedom for the past zillion years, and I think their road now must be to get connected to themselves and to the world, because this byproduct of this struggle for freedom is loneliness. And loneliness is, I think, the main killer of man. And asking questions and giving answers are the perfect middle way to connect. And why? Well, you know why. We are men. We like to answer. We like to know it better. We like to explain. We like to mansplain. That's what we do. Actually, we are dying to talk, and we are dying to feel, don't get me wrong, but we don't want to talk about those feelings up front. So please allow us men the byway of the rational question and the answer. So my big, hairy idea for today would be that we ask men better questions. And I've made up a few simple, pristine questions. One, what is a father? And two, what is freedom? And what is lovemaking? And what is a conversation? What is a boyhood? You can also try other ones, like, What roles are you playing? And which memory do you cherish? But also, which memory still haunts you? And what always brings tears to your eyes? And later on, ask yourself, do you think you're good enough? I think these are pretty straightforward questions, which will help you define what you're made of and to an inkling of where pain might be and relief might be found. And those are better questions than how much money do you make? Do you still love me the way you did? And how much beautiful is when we got married? Please ask better questions. It's so easy. And since we're males, you might do it in a male way. Make it a competition. Reward the answer. Boo the answer. It's okay. It may be hard to get into those answers the thinking way, the talking way. So I've come up with two aids. Whenever you're feeling down for a while and you don't know why, try to turn to your father. Because maybe there's something to be fixed there. But do not ask him to do that. Just let him talk about what he did and why he did it. And maybe he gets to say he loves you for what you are. And maybe, I don't know, that's what you've been waiting for. And you end being the asking son. I think this is way cooler to do in your midlife than buying a chopper. And the second is, please start reading books again. Because a lot of literature is about how a boy becomes man, or man becomes human. Actually, a lot of artists. And a good story will tell you you're not struggling alone. Please read. This all, of course, is just the beginning of a conversation, and maybe some healing. And don't forget, when there's a good reason for it, be not afraid to ask your friend, do you ever think about suicide? It can be a relieving question. This all I would have loved to have asked my fantastic brother David, although I'm not sure if that would have saved him. I'm sure the widows all would have loved to have asked their husbands better questions. But instead, Annika and Carla are raising their kids alone, and shame it is, because Clemens and Arthur were fantastic men. Thank God, for me now, there are way more fantastic brothers and sisters, comrades, who can start asking each other better questions and giving each other better answers. Thank you.